So let's go ahead and get started. My name is Kevin Donovan. I'm a program manager for the Office BI team, or sometimes referred to as SharePoint BI, depending on what you want to call it. So we're going to talk about Excel and Performance Point Services troubleshooting. So just a little bit about myself. I graduated from the University of Idaho back in 1996 and did some postgraduate work there and was really into the humanities. So I liked to read Chaucer and Shakespeare, and that was really important to me. Then I graduated and moved on and felt the lure of technology, which is how I wound up here today. But every now and then I go back and I kind of like to read Shakespeare, the old bard himself, kind of means a lot to me. So you can imagine my surprise as I'm going through and reading and find out that not only does he speak the language of sonnets and poetry and the histories and tragedies and comedies of his plays, but he also speaks Excel. Oh, come on, guys. Give me this. This is like a formula from the 16th century, right? I don't know what version of Excel he was using, but evidently formulas worked, so. Oh, the party's tonight. Loosen up a little bit, will you? All right. Okay, so anyways, let's get down to business. Sorry about that. So, like I said, I'm going to talk about Excel troubleshooting, performance point troubleshooting, and one of the biggest things that we've heard as we do these sessions is that, you know, learning how to configure those services is all fine and dandy, and that's not that difficult. But what is difficult is the other half of the story, and that's how do you really configure the services so that you can access external data, right? So what are the pitfalls and the gotchas around connecting to analysis services? What are all those weird errors that you get when you're in Excel services and you do data refresh and it says, oh, hey, I can't connect? So what I want to do is talk a lot about what those gotchas are, how to get around them, how do you configure both of those services so that when your user comes in and they click on a workbook out of their document library and they go to render that in Excel services, it just works, right? The data connectivity just works. That's what I hope to accomplish today. So I've talked to some people before the session, and there's everybody in here from, I just want to learn about what these services are, to I'm having trouble with load balancing and all kinds of stuff like that. And so hopefully I can give a sweeping overview to satisfy everybody's needs, but by all means, if you have specific questions, then come talk to me after the session, and we'll see if we can't get those answered. So Excel services, and Performance Point are two of the service applications that ship with SharePoint 2010, okay? And they're slightly different from the way that it worked in SharePoint 2007, right? In SharePoint 2007, you had what was known as a shared service provider, so just basically another machine that you ran all these services on. And you had to run all the services on that shared service provider, whether you liked it or not. It's just the way it worked. In SharePoint 2010, basically what happened is the SharePoint team sort of sledgehammered that whole concept of the shared service provider and decided to go with the service application architecture. And what that basically means is that now you can run your services, your back-end SharePoint services, kind of in a la carte type of fashion. So if I have a farm, I can dedicate some machines just to running like Performance Point services and Excel services and maybe Search or BDC or something like that, and then I don't have to run those on another machine. I can run different services altogether. So I can mix and match the services basically according to the architecture that I'm after. So whether I'm trying to load balance certain things, depending on what kind of performance I'm looking at, depending on all kinds of things, you may want to run these on different parts of your farm. That's what was the big difference between the two. And so with that, however, is the ability to configure each one of those services independently. And so that's sort of what leads up to this session. So then I'm going to talk about a little bit about the fundamental concepts like the secure store, right? That's one of the services that's common to both of Excel services and Performance Point. And then I want to do at the end is, and we'll do little demos along the way to show you where the what I'm talking about, what the context is of my particular slide or something like that. But then at the end, what I want to do is try to bring everything together. So we'll create like an end-to-end dashboard in Performance Point services. We will just use Excel services as our data source, and we'll have Excel services talking to a Power Pivot model on the back end. So really nothing there that's going to be overly shocking for a lot of people, but some stuff that's fundamentally difficult to do and for some folks, and so I hope to help you get through that. All right, so this is where we're going today. We are going to first talk about those common concepts, then we're going to get Excel services configured and all the data errors worked out, and then we're going to kind of do the same thing for Performance Point, and then bring it all together. All right, so the secure store. So the first share concept that I want to talk about, obviously, is the secure store. So the secure store replaces the SharePoint 2007 single sign-on feature. And it's basically a shared service that maps credentials, okay? So it enables you to provide credentials that are required to connect services to external systems, and then associate those credentials with identities or groups of identities. It includes a secure store database, right? Its own secure database. That's why if you look in SQL Server Management Studio, you will see a secure store database. And then it's used for connecting a service from a data source without using the app pool identity. And that's kind of one of the big changes also from SharePoint 2007 is that you don't connect to your data source anymore using the app pool identity, use the secure store. And the reason we moved away from the app pool identity is because it was an entirely too privileged of an account to be connecting to your back-end data sources. And the app pool identity has a lot of clout. And the last thing you need is for that account to be compromised somehow, and then all of a sudden, whoever has access to that account now has access to your line of business data as well. So that's why the secure store was implemented, especially for those services that connected to back-end data, like Performance Point and Excel services. So those are the basics of service applications, and now I want to get to the heart of configuring Excel services so that you can access data without issue. And so I do want to mention, though, that most of this presentation is weighted towards Excel services. I mean, we're going to do some stuff in Performance Point for sure, but the reason I wanted to talk a little bit more about Excel services than Performance Point is because all of the integration with back-end data that you have with Excel services. So, you know, you have all kinds of different providers that are involved with Excel services in addition to Power Pivot. So if people are using Power Pivot, then Excel services is going to be the thing for you. All right, so what I want to do is just try and get some context here, show you what I'm talking about. We're going to create and configure an Excel services service application and then show where the trusted location stuff is, because I want to kind of go in order of the configuration, and trusted locations are kind of a big deal. So here we just have a basic workbook. And if we go into, let's go into Central Admin in SharePoint. So there's a couple areas that we're going to be talking about here. And the first one that I wanted to show you was in here. So you'll go into Application Management, and a lot of you may be familiar with this already. You'll go into Manage Service Applications. And you can see that these are all where I have all those service applications running that I just mentioned. Here's my Secure Store service. Here's my Excel Services service application. And then here's my Performance Point service application. So the way you create an Excel services service application is, aside, I'm not going to do any demos around PowerShell, but you can create these same things in PowerShell. is you click under here and you click on Excel Services application. And you enter a name, so we would do like whatever, right? Here's you have the opportunity to create a separate app pool, or you can use the SharePoint built-in app pool accounts that run the system itself. And then that's pretty much it. And then this by default here, you have this checkbox that allows you to connect the service application proxy to the default web app. Now, what this means is the service application proxy, what that means is when you connect from the web front end to your app server in the back end, you do that through what's called a proxy, right? And you can think of a proxy as kind of a conduit, right? A pipe that connects those two things. And so you can connect different services to different web apps on the back end using the proxy, but you have to specify which proxy you want to connect to which web service on your SharePoint farm. So that's what that means. Now, if we go over to create a new performance point service application, you see it differs a little bit. You still have to enter a name, and you still have the checkbox for the service application default proxy. Now, you notice ours is unchecked, and Excel Services one is checked by default. There's no rhyme or reason for that. It's just two different product teams deciding whether or not to make that checkbox the default. But performance point has its own database, right? That's where we store things like persisted user filter values, right? So that when if you go in back into Performance Point and you filter it on the dashboard and you go back in, that filter stays the same next time you go back into that dashboard. We store that information in the database. We store some caching in the database. And then we store comments from your scorecard. So if you make a comment on a particular scorecard, KPI, that also gets stored in the Performance Point database, not in the SharePoint content database. So here you can specify your databases and that kind of thing. And then here, obviously, you have the same app pool stuff that's going on. So and then if we go back over to our Excel Services, I'm going to show you, just keep reminding you how to get there, your Excel Services service app. The first part we're going to talk about is this trusted file locations, because if you don't have, if you do decide to configure trusted locations, this can give you some heartache if it's not done right. So within trusted locations, you can, so obviously you specify the trusted location address, and I'll demo that in a couple minutes here. But then you also have things like session timeouts, and these are not the default session timeouts. I've set these way low, so that I think they default to like 480 or something like that. But I set them to 15 so that when we do trusted locations demos, it doesn't cache the workbook. If it caches the workbook, then that demo doesn't work out very well. So anyways, then we're going to talk about things like allow external data. We're going to spend some time around here because that's important. And then that's really all that's super important for us as far as this session goes, is the external data piece and then the trusted locations. We are also going to get into some sections. So if we go back to our Excel Services, in this global settings, we're going to talk about that a little bit as far as this application ID goes, because this is going to be a big thing when you're connecting to external data. All right, so that's kind of where we are in terms of context. So, trusted file location. So in the context of this presentation, trusted locations are basically just repositories, right? They're like libraries any library, really, in SharePoint, that Excel Calculation Services can access and deliver data from. And they can be enabled or disabled from that section that I just showed you in Central Admin. And it allows Excel Services to work out of the box. So they are enabled. It's wide open by default. So if you've configured them, that's where you could get into some issues. But they are open by default. And you saw that when we went in there. There was that HTTP address, whack, whack, and then that's it, nothing after that. The reason that we decided to leave that wide open is because it's an administrative function, And the last thing from a business perspective that you want to do is have to have your administrators decide which locations in SharePoint should be trusted and not trusted. It's really a business decision, and we did not want to put the onus on the administrator to have to figure that out. So if Excel Services has trusted locations configured on the server and workbooks aren't stored there, Excel Services won't open them. Okay, and so this is the error that you'll see if that's the case. Just like that. So even if you have a workbook stored in a trusted document library, you still need to configure the ability to allow external data connections from that library. So you can have a situation where your workbook is trusted because it's in a trusted location, but it won't connect to external data unless it's configured to do so. What else? Oh yeah, you can configure this within that app service settings like I showed you, and we're going to do that in a second here. So in this first box, this is the error that appears when you've explicitly disallowed data connections from Excel Services. Now the second box is a little bit of a confusing case, and I just kind of wanted to point that out because it's a bit of a corner case, and that's largely what this session is about, is finding those corner cases. If you're trying to use embedded connections, and I'll kind of try and slow down for this, if you're trying to use embedded connections, so let's say you're embedding a PowerPivot workbook in your Excel workbook, you need to make sure that the embedded connections are allowed, right? And that's what this bottom radio button does. You can see the bottom radio button. But it can still lead to a bit of a confusing problem. So if you have the last radio button checked, right, and you don't have the always use connection file checkbox checked, and you've specified an ODC string, the first thing that Excel, so if you have this situation, the first thing Excel Services is going to try to do is use the embedded connection string to connect to the external data. If that fails, if that connection were to fail somehow, you're going to get a data refresh error. And what Excel Services is going to try to do at that point is it's going to try and leverage that ODC file to go ahead and try again. Now, if that connection succeeds, your refresh is going to take place and you'll get data. But you're going to get an error, your users are going to see an error that says, hey, your embedded connection failed. So even though they got the data back, they're still going to get an error that says their embedded connection failed. All right. Now let's say that the ODC connection, the Office Data Connection file, also fails. And obviously your data won't refresh, but you're still going to get that error about the embedded connection failing, and you won't see any more information about the ODC file connection failing. So it's just kind of an interesting situation how you're going to keep getting that error about the embedded connection failing, even though it and the ODC connection both fail. So I just wanted to point that out, and it's kind of confusing, but we can definitely talk more about that situation if you want to. So this is a big one here. With the advent of PowerPivot and the add-in for Excel, this is critical that if you're connecting to a workbook that has a PowerPivot embedded model in it and you aren't saying in Central Admin, you know, trusted data connection libraries and embedded, then your connection to your PowerPivot workbook is going to fail. And you'll notice I highlighted that embedded, because that's what that means. The source is embedded, so you have to have this and embedded connection set when you go to connect to your PowerPivot data. So, anybody interested in seeing an untrusted document demo? All right. So we're kind of back where we were here. And I have set up in SharePoint, I have two document libraries, untrusted documents and trusted documents. If you go into trusted documents, you click on this, it should render trusted. And everything should work. Now let's just go in and take that out, and we'll say, So we go into our trusted file locations. And make sure I get this right. So I named it trusted documents. So if you go in and you say your server name, now one thing I want to point out here is that I've seen people confuse this, and when they enter in here, they're entering in what they want to block and not what they want to allow. So don't forget that this is what you want to allow as trusted, not what you want to block. I'll click OK. And assuming I've typed that right, if I come over here, I could still open my trusted location. And this is why I set those timeouts really low. So if I click on untrusted, I should get blocked. Yeah, see, this is what happens if you don't have that trusted. So let me just go back in. And if you don't mind, I'm going to take this back out, because any other demo that accesses that location is going to fail pretty miserably. All right. OK, the Office Data Connection file, and this is a big one. The Office Data Connection file is really basically just a convenient way to connect to a data source without having to specify the parameters around a connection string that you have embedded in your workbook. So one of the advantages of using ODC files is that any update that you make to that ODC file can be picked up by anybody who uses it. And that's one of the cool things about it, is that you can make property changes to your connection string in that ODC file, then just put it out in a document library and have everybody connect to that instead of having them fuss around with changing the parameters in their Excel connection string. The other cool advantage of ODC files is that I personally think this is cool anyways, if you double-click an ODC file, it's going to launch Excel and automatically generate a connection to the data source that's specified in that ODC file. So you don't have to have somebody go out and browse to the ODC file and then connect it up through Excel manually that way. It's already automatically connected the second you open it. So anyway, this is the error that you'll see if you reference an ODC file that's missing, right? Or where the user doesn't have access to the library that contains that ODC file. So if you see this error, it's likely that the ODC file has been deleted, right, from that connection library, or the permissions on it have somehow changed. Has anybody really ever looked inside of an ODC file? Yeah, let's go do that. I'm going to take care of some stuff here. So I have basically an ODC file that I've saved to my desktop. And let's look at the structure of those real quick. So first of all, we go back, click out of here. This is your data connection library, and I have a couple in here, and I've named one SSS, and we're going to get to what that means in a second here, but I've named the other one non-SSS. And so I want to show you the differences between the two, and the reason I named one SSS is because I wanted to show that it was exported from Excel using, so if we go into connections, we add a connection, and we look at the properties of that connection, the authentication settings, we're going to get into the authentication settings. Your ODC file contains a reference to where this secure store service identifier. So if we look at the differences between those two ODC files, so here's what I was talking about. When you double-click one, it automatically creates a connection in Excel to that ODC file. I'll make sure I wanted to show you how to do that. But if you look at it using Notepad, you can see that one of the properties is, open the other one too. Darn it, didn't mean to do that, sorry. You kind of look at these side by side, you can see what the difference is here. That this one contains this SSO application ID in Excel services. So if I actually change this here, let's say I call this Excel services 12, for example, and I save that, and I go back in to my data. And I browse to that on my desktop. And then I look at my authentication settings. You can see that it picks that up. So Excel reads that ODC file in order to change stuff. So this is what I was saying when people can't connect using that ODC file. I mean, if somebody else who has permissions to change that ODC file does something like that, then all of a sudden you could break the connection for other users who are using, trying to connect to that ODC file. So, or changing the permissions on where it lives, for example. So, trusted data connection libraries. And they're a lot like trusted locations, but they're basically locations just for ODC files. So if you know that you have access to an ODC file, and it's definitely in a data connection library, that library needs to be trusted by SharePoint. So that's another thing that is in part of that trusted locations area inside of Central Admin, is the ability to trust ODC locations. So that first error, this is what you get if your ODC file is not in a trusted location. And it's also worth noting that if you publish a workbook that makes an external data connection with a provider that's not trusted, this is the error that you're going to get there as well. And the funny thing about this one is that you can see the error. This is exactly what I'm talking about that users have to suffer through sometimes. Unable to refresh data for a connection in the workbook, try again or contact your administrator. It's like, okay, that's super helpful, right? But what is, where you do get information about what that error really means is in the event log. This is one of the few errors that is actually sent straight to the event log without giving the user too much information about what's going on. And so if you don't mind, I kind of want to show you, I don't really have a demo set up for this, but I still think it's good to look at. So inside of Central Admin, so let's look at my workbook properties for a second. So you can see that this msolap.5 is the provider for 2008 R2 analysis services. And so if I go into Central Admin, and I go back to Excel services, and I look at trusted data providers. Here's all the trusted data providers that I can use to connect to Excel services. Here's this one down at the end. So if you're going to connect to Excel services you're going to connect Excel services to a different kind of data source, you need to make sure that whatever provider you use to connect to that data source is part of this trusted locations. Does that make sense? All right, so now what? Your workbook's in a trusted location, does allow for data connections, that looks good. Data source locations are all trusted, everybody's happy. Authentication is probably the culprit in this case, and this is where things get a little tricky. I mean, trusted locations are pretty straightforward, especially because they're open by default. So, creating workbook connections. When I started putting this session together, I just wanted to make sure that I was along the right path. And so I called a bunch of the Microsoft escalation engineers for Excel services, and I said, you know, I just want to make sure, what's your number one support call? And they said, you know, far and away, 90% of the support calls that they get from regular users are, how come I can't connect to external data? What's the deal? And most of the support calls within that group of people who can't connect to external data has to do with whatever kind of authentication that they're using, whether they haven't set up Kerberos right or they haven't configured the secure store correctly. Those are the kinds of things that I wanted to get into next, because that's one of those pieces that that'll really get you. So let's take a look at the client-server authentication options in a little more depth. So if we go back here, you notice that with every connection string, this is your Windows credential. So it's going to try your Windows credential first, no matter what. That's just by default. And you can specify other kinds of security on that connection string, but by default, it's going to try your Windows connection. Now, we saw this a little bit in the last demo, but this is where your authentication options live. Here's your Windows authentication option. I've kind of said this already, but a lot of people say, what does SSS stand for? It stands for Secure Store Service, and then you have none. And they all do very different things. And so we're going to talk about what those do in a second. So this is your client authentication. And each of these work in conjunction with the authentication option that's set in Excel services, right? Remember we looked at that global settings? So way at the bottom here, this is the other piece. And you cannot leave that blank if you are using some of those client authentication options. So the way these work is, like I said, this one will use your Windows authentication. This is a secure store service. So when you publish your workbook to Excel services, it's going to use whatever target app ID you've added to the secure store in order to make that connection. Now, here's the thing. The SSS ID, it's the only authentication option that where your connection string to your data source actually gets changed by Excel services. So for Windows authentication, it's just going to pass that connection string straight over with that SSS PI or ID that I showed you before. None is going to do something different, and I'll explain that in a second. But SSS, your connection string actually gets changed before you log into the data source. So what happens is Excel services will go into the secure store, go in, crack open that target application ID, pull out the credentials from the target application ID, and replace whatever credentials you had on the connection string for the secure store, or for when you connected to your data source, and plunk those credentials on that connection string that it got from the target app ID in the secure store. Does that make sense? And then none is a little different still. See, and the description is not really that clear. Use the information stored in the connection string to connect to the data source. That's mostly true, because it is using the connection string to connect to the data source, but the way it's logging into the data source, right? So it's logging into the data source using this. It's using that target app ID that's stored in the secure store to actually log into the data source, and then it's taking the connection string and whatever credentials you had on it and passing that over. And again, the reason we did this, the reason we're using this target app ID right there to log into the data source is because so that we didn't have to log into the backend data source using the app pool identity, right? So that's the way those three different authentication options work on the client. Anybody know all that already? Okay. All right. So let's go through each one of those authentication options in a little more detail. So I want to talk about the Windows authentication option first. And I want to point out that Windows Auth for Excel services is probably the thing that you will use the least. You will probably not use Windows authentication for Excel services. It's great in the client, right? Because you're already authenticated as yourself in the client, and it's everything's integrated with Windows credentials, and it works great. But for Excel services, in order to authenticate with your Windows credentials, what you're going to have to do is you're going to have to probably configure Kerberos on your farm, right? Because of the delegation requirements that the domain has in SharePoint 2010, so constrained delegation. So it will work if you are on the same machine, right, and you only have to make a single hop to your data source, but if you're making multiple hops across a farm, then you're gonna have to configure Kerberos delegation in order to get your Windows authentication to work. And then that obviously brings up things like the claims to Windows token service. Anybody familiar with the claims to Windows token service? Okay, cool. We are gonna talk a little bit about that too and why you need it. So let's move on. Let's talk about it right now. So what is it? So the claims to Windows token service is a service that's, like I said, mainly used in conjunction with Kerberos authentication. If you are using the secure store for your authentication to your data sources, you really don't need to start this service. And it's in the list of SharePoint services. It's right there, claims to Windows token for service. You start it if you're going to be using Kerberos delegation. The reason that this service exists is because of the new claims authentication framework that was created as part of SharePoint 2010. All right, so basically what happens is when you come in through the browser with your Windows identity, when you hit that front end, that Windows identity gets converted to a claims identity, and it's that claims identity that then gets passed to the back end, so that it gets passed to your app server. What the Claims to Windows token service does at that point is it goes in and it changes that claims identity back to a Windows identity so that you can log into your backend data source, right? And that's partly because at this point, and most people connect to analysis services for this kind of stuff, but the problem is analysis services doesn't understand how to read a claims identity. It knows how to read a Windows identity. I've heard that's coming, but as of now, they can only read a Windows identity, so that's what the service was created to handle, that specific scenario. So regardless of the authentication type that you are using, if that user doesn't have read access to the data source, Excel Services is going to throw that first error. If you don't have a login to the data source, it's going to throw that second error. Two different errors, same category of stuff, right? Login versus access, two different errors. So if you're trying to troubleshoot that, all you have to do is log into Analysis Services, make sure whoever's connecting, if it's a per user, make sure that person has access to it or they're in some kind of role that has access to it. Or if they're using the unattended service account, you need to make sure that that has access to it and it has a role. And then the dreaded Kerberos error. So anybody in here set up Kerberos before? Did you like it? Was it fun? It's easier now than it was, but it's still not a pleasant experience.
It's the only option if you've got the security at the analysis services.
Until now. So I'm going to talk about one other option here that's fairly new. And that's the BISM file. Are you familiar with BISM files? So this is a new thing with Denali, so with SQL Server 2012. If you have installed SQL Server 2012 for SharePoint, one of the things that you get is a BISM file content type. So you know what content types are in SharePoint, right? If you go to New Document, you see all those different kind of content types. One of those in there that you can add to your document library is called a BISM file. And one of the things that it does, and the reason why it was created, is so that you could actually connect to AS without having to configure Kerberos delegation. And the way it works is kind of like this. So when a service uses impersonation to authenticate, the domain hands back a particular kind of token called an identify level token. Now that identify level token can't really do anything on your behalf. It can't connect to services on your behalf or do anything like that, but it does contain information about you, like who you are, and what kind of groups you belong to. So if you're connecting to analysis services via this BISM file, and it sees that you're using an identify level token from the domain, what it's going to do is it's going to add what's called the effective username property to the end of that connection string to analysis services. And so that you don't have to configure Kerberos authentication, it's going to look at the calling thread, who's making that call, and it's going to add that username as the property of the effective username. Pretty cool stuff. So when analysis services gets that connection string and it sees that the effective username is on there and it sees whoever is, what property is added to that, or what value is added to that effective username property, it's going to look in to see if that user is a member of any of the roles in AS and then grant access accordingly. It's really cool stuff, and it's going to save it's going to save administrators a big headache when they go to configure analysis services. Yes?
The effective username, does that apply to groups also from that security token, or is it only the username?
It's only the username, but what you do is you configure the groups on the AS side. And so it looks to see if that user is part of any of those groups in AS. Yeah, the user, right, so the question was, can you add groups to the value of the effective username? And the answer is no, because it's going to look at the calling thread of the user who's trying to make the, you know, who's making the call. And then it's AS is going to look to see, hey, what member does this user belong to? And then it's going to add, grant access to that, to those resources. There's one other question. Yeah. Well, so that's a good question, and it's kind of a long-winded answer. So let's talk about that after the session. So, okay. So target app credentials in a secure store. So most of the authentication options in Excel services involve the secure store and setting those target app credentials. And so remember that target app credentials are basically organized list of mapped credentials, right, to external sources. So to create one, you first have to set the members who are going to map to a set of credentials that will ultimately access the data source. And that part's easy when you add those members because the secure store has a little people picker, right? So it'll validate that user, that group that you're adding. The hard part is when you actually set the credentials that will access the data to begin with. And that's not as straightforward because for a couple of reasons. First of all, you have to, I guess what I'm trying to say is when you go back in to look at what you've set up after the fact, there's no validation involved. And when you go to look at it again, all the values that you had entered are blanked out. And the reason is it's a security measure so that just any admin can't go in and look to see who was set up on that target application to access those, to access that backend data source. Only the app pool account for Excel services can log into the secure store and grab those credentials. And I'll show you that in a second as to what I mean regarding that, because we are going to do a demo on the secure store. So now let's talk about the SSS workbook connection. So when you specify this option, you're telling Excel services to use the target application to connect to the data source, that target application that you specify in the SSS field. So whether you're using embedded connections or the ODC file, it's the same thing. I showed you how the ODC file contains a reference to that target app ID. The way it works when using Windows credentials in that target app ID, now I didn't say Windows using Windows credentials from the user, but when you enter Windows credentials in the secure store target app ID, is that Excel service is going to log into the secure store, it's going to grab the credentials from that target app ID, and it's going to put them on the connection string when making that connection to the external data source. So notice also a little bit in the UI. You can't select the target app ID. It's not. One of the cool things about this is that would have been cool anyway is if there was some kind of drop down there that showed you like what target app IDs you can pick, right? That would have been great. But at least in this version, that doesn't exist. So you have to know the target app ID that you're gonna enter into that field. And so unfortunately for most users, what they're gonna have to do is probably talk to somebody on the administrative side that says, you know, what target app IDs do I have available to me that I can use that have the right permissions to get to X, Y, or Z data source, right? So my recommendation is just to publish a list somewhere, maybe in SharePoint, that says, hey, if you need to connect to this data source, then use this target app ID. If you need to connect to this data source, then use that target app ID. A particular gotcha here involves data refresh on PowerPivot models. So if you use PowerPivot to grab backend data, you need to add the data refresh account for PowerPivot. So I don't know if you've gone in to look at the service applications for PowerPivot, but it adds a target app ID to the secure store when you install. If you're doing in SharePoint mode, it'll add one. You just need to make sure that the account in that target app ID that PowerPivot adds is a member of the target app ID in the secure store, so it can do data refresh.
How does that impact the, if you define some security within Visual Studio or PowerPivot, how does that impact the security? That means that you have only one username for the whole PowerPivot table?
No, that's slightly different. And again, let's talk about that. I do in this session go right up to the minute. So hold that question, and we'll talk about it some more because that's a good one. So let's configure the secure store here. And I want to create a target app ID, and then I want to try and connect some data using the SSS option, so you can see how that works. All right, so if we go back in, so I'll cancel this stuff out. So I have a secure store service, and we'll create a new one called sounds good, right? Those don't have to be different. This, you can actually add anything here. We're going to choose group. There's a difference between group and individual. Group is when you add multiple. You can add a group or multiple individuals to the list of people that can get to a data source. So that group of people will funnel down into a single user that will then log into the data source. Whereas an individual is more of a one-to-one. So you have the credential that will log into the data source, and then you have one mapped credential on the other side who's a member of that. So most people choose group. In fact, I really don't know anybody who uses individual. Anybody here use individual as the type? Okay. So we're going to talk a little bit about this later on, but these can be Windows username and password. You can set this up so it will store like SQL credentials or any other credential for that matter, like to your line of business application, for example. So here's what I was talking about. So this is the target app administrator. So I'll just make that like me. And then this is what I was talking about. You can actually use the people picker here and here. So they will validate who those people are. So we'll just add like all authenticated users. It's trying to validate me. There we go. So here it is, right? But we're not done. You still have to go in and you actually have to set the credentials that will be accessing the data source itself. So this is what I was talking about, where it's not as straightforward. There's no validation here. Actually, well, I take that back. There's a little bit of validation. I'll show you what that is. So if you enter a domain name, and then you have to enter the password here, and the only thing it validates is that the password and the confirm password, those match. If they don't, that's the only error you'll get. But if it's the wrong password, it doesn't tell you. At least not here. So I could have entered a password that didn't actually match my domain name, and it wouldn't have said anything. So it doesn't validate when you click OK. It just validates that those two are the same. So now I have my Excel Services demo. I can come in here. And then I should be able to like just insert a pivot table using that data source. So there's my data, and you can just, you know, go crazy on your pivot table or your chart or whatever the case may be. So that's what I want to talk about, those validation pieces specifically in the secure store. That's a good question. If you're using an ODC file, do you need to check that box that says always use ODC file? So he's talking about this guy right here. So if I had browsed to an ODC file, no, you don't have to. Like I said in that other slide, it's going to try that connection string first. And then if that succeeds, you've got your data. Only check that. Then you would want to do that, yeah.
I didn't hear that.
If you're centralizing your connections and your ODC connections, like in a data connection library, then you'd want to have this box checked so that you always, you know, you pointed at those ODC connections that you wanted to use. Yeah, good question. Uh-huh. That's a good question. You know, I don't know if there is a report. The question was is for the users that you have in the secure store that are a member of a target app ID, can you run a report on there to see? I guess if you took them out of the domain, then they would not have access, right? But as far as running a report to see, well, you'd be adding groups there, so I think you'd be okay. I guess the only question would be if you had a whole bunch of target app IDs that were the individual type, then you might run into some trouble. You know, I can ask the secure store group to see if there's some kind of report. Is that something you're interested in generating? Okay, yeah. Come see me after the session. I'll make sure I note that. All right, so let's get back to this a little bit. I want to get to that, make sure I get to that demo. And performance point. Okay, so using SQL credentials in the secure store. And does anybody use SQL credentials in their secure store? Okay, cool. So this will be good information for everybody then. So if you're using SQL credentials in the secure store, a couple things need to happen. So you'll need to create two application IDs. You'll need to create one app ID, target app ID in the secure store for the client. And then you'll also need to create a second application ID on the server. And you recognize where that second screenshot's from, right? That's on the service applications page. And the reason you need to do this is because that first target app ID in the first window, that's going to be the target app ID that stores the SQL credentials, right, where you've entered the SQL credentials. Maybe we came to that screen where it said Windows credentials and Windows username. You would enter your SQL credentials there. And then you also need to create a second one that uses some kind of Windows credential, right? Remember I said AS doesn't understand anything other than Windows credentials? The reason is, so for that second one, you would add your a target app ID that contained Windows credentials. That's going to be the one that logs into AS. And then it's going to pass a connection string from the target app ID that contains the SQL credentials. So a lot of not a lot of people remember to do that or know to do that, but that's one of those gotchas. Yeah, I'm going to go into the secure store, create a target app ID with SQL credentials because I know you can do it, and then it fails. Why? Because you need that second one so you can actually log into the server. Okay, and then the none authentication setting. I talked about this a little bit before, but you need to make sure that you've added the application ID to the service and use the none authentication setting regardless of what's on your connection string when you connect. So if you don't configure the unattended service account and you use none, you at least get an error that's obvious to users as to what's going on. There's nothing that they can do about it, but they can at least tell their administrators that needs to happen. So the main thing that I want to note here is that you must add the Excel Services app pool account to the members of the target application ID. So I'll say that again. You need to add the Excel Services app pool account to the members of the target app that you're using. If you don't, you're going to get connection errors. So these are just all kind of lessons I've learned from people saying, hey, I can't connect, and we just go through troubleshooting, and I need to add this account to this in the target app, I need to add this account to there, I need to make sure that the app pool account has access to the SharePoint document library, blah, blah, blah. So hopefully you're getting something out of this as well. Yay, Excel Services works. Okay, so data connections, trusted locations, authentications, or authenticating. So we're almost there. Now let's talk a little bit about Performance Point services. So we're going to enable site collection features. We're going to create a BI Center site. And we're going to create a PPS chart with document lists and libraries that are. Now, who here uses Performance Point regularly? Okay. Has anybody gone through and not used the default lists and libraries that come with Performance Point or the BI Center that comes with the Performance Point and created the content types themselves? Okay, that's kind of what I was going to show how to do for those of you who haven't done it. So if we go into here, if you're a regular user of Performance Point services, the way you go in to create a dashboard is you launch Dashboard Designer, right? And the way you launch Dashboard Designer is you go in, you create, typically an admin will create a BI Center site for somebody that they want to have use Dashboard Designer. And they would go in and there's a site template. And what that site template does is create a nice little site that allows you to launch Dashboard Designer and create your dashboard. But you'll notice that there's no site for BI Center in here. We have meeting space, blog, all kinds of stuff in here. Nothing for Performance Point. By the same token, we don't have any libraries that are for Performance Point. We have the data connections library. Our list. Okay, we do have this. Now, I meant to show you why we have that. This won't show up. So this Performance Point content list will not show up if you don't have the site collection and site features enabled. So these show up because of site collections and site features. So if we go into site settings and you look at your site collection features, make sure that you have the Performance Point site collection features activated. That's really important, otherwise Dashboard Designer won't work. You also need to make sure you have your managed site features activated. So here's the Performance Point site features. And just as a demo, I'll deactivate this. And then I'll go back into libraries and create a new library. And if I went back over to a list, now that performance point one is gone. Remember it had the little graph, it was like right in here. Now that's gone because I disabled that list. So, but the way you can do this is if you don't have that list, is these are just content types. So when we add this list for you based on that feature, we're just doing a favor for you. We're just adding the content types that Dashboard Designer needs to read in order to be able to write content back to that list. So just for the heck of it, I'll just go back in and re-enable that. And if I go back into libraries, create a library. Now it's back. So that's all that does. So we'll just create one of these real quick. And here it is. And then what we're going to do is we're going to create a library real quick. So data connections for performance point. So if you go into this library and you add documents, you'll see that we have a performance point data source. So the fact that that library, that template was there for you, all it does is add this data, add this content type. And the reason you need this content type is so that when you launch this and Dashboard Designer launches. Come on. There we go. It's going to automatically add that library to my workspace. See, there's the PPS data library. If those content types weren't there, Dashboard Designer would not be able to write to it. So we'll just create an analysis services data source.
Right now you're requesting all libraries or data connections.
So yeah, that's a good question. So the question was, are you trusting all libraries and data connections at the top level? And one of the things I didn't talk about, because it's a little short on time, but Performance Point also has the concept of trusted locations, but they're different from Excel's concept of trusted locations. They're two different things. Now, yes, by default, you have to, wherever I store this PPS data library is part of Performance Point's service settings, and so this is trusted for Performance Point in order to save that data connection object there. And that's a really good question. People say, well, how do I keep people from using certain data connections for Performance Point? And that's kind of what we recommend is, hey, you know, just untrust that for certain groups, and then they won't be able to get to that location. So this should connect back to, actually, my Boise server is where we live. If it's up and going. If not, that's okay too. Okay, there we go. So we can just use like VentureWorks spatial data or whatever. And we connect to the cube. Now, one of the things I wanted to say was that if I add list, this PPS content, there's where we added that. Again, if we didn't have that list with all those content types in it, Performance Point Dashboard Designer would not find it. So there's our PPS content, and then we can create a chart based on our data source. And then, of course, we can add measures and dimensions and create the chart. So what we'll do, what's this? All right. What I want to do is just kind of get into that other demo about make sure we can create a dashboard based on all the Power Pivot data as well as the Excel services stuff that we talked about, because I know that there's some people in here that specifically wanted to see that. So let me get to that section real quick, and then we'll come back to this. So common performance point errors and fixes. Talked about some of these already, but here's some stuff that I really wanted to point out to you. So if you use a domain account for your PPS app pool, you need to grant the user DB owner privileges to the content database for that web app. And this is like a big deal. People run across this all the time. If you're using an app pool account for a performance point, you need to make sure you run these two commandlets. And I have blogged about these two commandlets, but what it does is a couple things. So it creates a new user in the WSS content database. It makes the user a member of the DB owner role, that app pool account, the DB owner role, and then it creates a new schema for that user. So if you don't do these things, you're going to get errors about how come I can't connect to my data source, and that's 9 times out of 10, that's why, if you're using a domain account for your app pool for the PPS service. SharePoint backup and restore. If you use backup and restore on SharePoint to backup and restore your PPS content, when you restore, you need to make sure that you're restoring to the exactly the same site collection name on your new server. If you don't, the references to the PPS objects will break. Backup and restore does not work very well if you're using SharePoint backup and restore for performance point. We saw this with Excel services, and it's the same with performance point. One of the biggest oversights when it comes to connecting Excel services data sources through PPS is forgetting to add the unintended service account to the document library that it needs to access. That's a huge one. And so then these are the things that we went through. One of the things that I wanted to make sure I mention is that for permissions, when you run Dashboard Designer, there's two different things going on here. You have to be at least a designer permission level in SharePoint to run Dashboard Designer, and you need to be at least a contributor in order to save that data back to SharePoint. So two different things here. Okay, so let's configure that end-to-end scenario that I talked about. So let's jump right to it here. I'm just going to go ahead and delete this data source. So what we're going to do is just we're going to build a quick dashboard that uses Power Pivot backend data. It's going to pull that data in from analysis services, and then we're going to take that and put it on a performance point dashboard and hook it up with a performance point filter. So I have a couple of data sources that I've already created in the essence of time, and we're going to use this products category PP. Stands for Power Pivot. So if we open this in Excel, so here's just, you know, basic stuff. And what I'm doing is I'm saying, hey, this, you know, David R. Campbell here, so it's going to go out and connect to that data. You know, I would change that to like Amy Alberts or whatever, right? And then the data changes. And just to prove I'm not lying, when I open up this Power Pivot window, you can see that I do have data in this model. See, there's the data. It's not a lot of data, just a little bit, but just to kind of show you what I'm talking about. So what we're going to do is we're going to take this and put it in one performance point object. We're going to take this and put it on another performance point object, but instead of using this to make this data change, we're going to hook it up with a performance point filter instead. So this is how you do that. When you go to publish this, the first thing you need to make sure you do when you do a save and send to SharePoint is in your publish options, you may need to make sure you send whatever filter you're going to be sending your performance point filter for needs to be a parameter in Excel, right? If you don't have this set up, your filter won't work. So you need to make sure you have a parameter. So I have a parameter out there named employee. Okay, so if I go back over here, I click here, this field right here is employee. So that's really the key to getting all this to work, is that one parameter filter. So if I go back over here and I've named this products category PP, we're going to create a data source. That uses that workbook. So we're going to create a connection string style. Specify your server name. That's a good question. So the question was, do you not need to say, because there are some blogs out there saying, you know, you need to go like provider equals, MS OLAP, I think it is. No, that's redundant. You don't need to do that. That was actually a documentation error from the group that created the documentation for it. So all you need to do is say data source equals. And then I just pulled that down so I can make sure I type it. I called this So that's all you really need. Then you connect to your cube. Uh-oh, what did I forget to do here? Did I mistype this? Oh, thank you. Minor oversight, right? What would I do without you guys? Okay, so it found the cube. All right, so now they have my data source. I'll just save that guy. And what I'll do now is go in and create some visualizations off of that data source. So go into Home, PPS Content. We'll create an Excel Services report. Share documents, grab the workbook. And the first thing we'll do is add our pivot table. Okay? So we'll okay. We're going to create one more. Then we'll grab our chart. Now we're going to grab a quick dashboard here. We'll make it two rows. These are represent the zones in SharePoint. We'll put our chart out there and our table. And now what we need to do is just create that filter real quick, a performance point filter. We're going to do a member selection filter, use our data source. We're going to select the employee dimension because we want to change that name, remember, from Amy. So there's, I'm going to select my children. We'll just make it a list. So my filter is now created. So what I do now is go over back to my dashboard, and I'm going to drop that filter right on my dashboard. There's my new filter. Put it on my dashboard. Now the only thing I need to do is hook up my member unique name to each one of these things. Remember I said you have to add that employee parameter or some kind of parameter that you can use to connect? And I'll grab member unique name and drop it over here too. Connect to employee. And that's it. I just deploy this sucker to SharePoint. Now, I didn't do any sizing and that kind of thing, so it's going to be a little squished, but you get the point. So you can see, you know, I have to expand these a little bit, but Garrett R. Vargas matches Garrett R. Vargas. If I go in, I change this back to Amy E. Alberts. Now it's at Amy E. Alberts. And if you really wanted to get fancy, you could come in here and say, all right, now I'm just going to, like, I'm going to hide this. Save it back to SharePoint. Come back over here to my dashboard. And theoretically, if I hit F5, then that should go away. Obviously, my filter's not working now. But I left that other piece up there so that you could see that, indeed, the performance point filter was changing the Excel services accordingly. So sorry about my filter breaking, however. But it does actually work. There we go. So this is the way you would set up a filter to connect to Excel services. The downside is of using Excel services is that you don't get things like the decomp tree and that kind of thing, which I really didn't have a lot of time to go into, but we can talk about how you would get that to work as well. So anyway, I appreciate everybody's time. Don't forget to fill out your evaluations. Looks like we went right up to the minute, just like I thought we would in this session. I appreciate you coming to this. I know you have a lot of choices, and thank you for attending this one.